Friday the 10th of September, 1909, Mr. and Mrs. George Harry Storrs were entertaining a widowed neighbour to dinner at their comfortable home, Gorse Hall, above Stalybridge, Cheshire. At 9:30, the ladies were sitting at the table waiting for food to be served, and George Harry was in an armchair beside the fire reading a book. Suddenly, he saw a figure lurking outside the window. As he hurried over to see who this was, a gun barrel smashed the glass, and a man's voice shouted, "Hands up or I'll shoot!" Undeterred, Mr. Storrs continued to the window and pulled the blind down. Two shots rang out. They were not fired into the room, for the blind was undamaged, and no cartridges or powder marks were found. And Mr. Storrs would have rushed out into the garden after the intruder had not his wife held him back. Instead, a maid opened the front door a little and rang a handbell for the coachman, James Worrell. Worrell was dispatched to the police station in Stalybridge, but by the time constables arrived, the mysterious defenestrator had vanished, and the Storrses were unable to hazard a guess as to who he might have been. The house was relatively isolated in its own grounds. It had no telephone, and the police placed two constables on watch in the grounds at night for the time being. They also endorsed Mr. Storrs's suggestion that he should install a large alarm bell on the roof. The police may have regretted encouraging this amenity on October the 29th. At midnight that night, the bell pealed out across the town, waking most of Stalybridge and sending half the police force scurrying up to see what new threat had occurred. They found Mr. Storrs standing calmly in his door with his watch in his hand. He checked the time of their arrival with the clock in the hall, offered them mulled ale for their trouble, and went to bed satisfied with his little test. Three nights later, the bell sounded again. This time there were no constables in the grounds, and precious few in town to answer its summons. For November the 1st was municipal election night. None of the Stalybridge wards were being contested, and the bulk of the local police had been sent to places where the polls were closing to make sure that the celebration of victory and drowning of sorrows did not get out of hand. At 9:15, Mary Evans, the cook at Gorse Hall, saw a man in the kitchen. Mistaking him for the coachman, she said, "Oh, Worrell, how you frightened me!" Her mistake was instantly rectified, as he pointed a gun at her and said quietly, "Say a word and I shoot." Mary Evans rushed out of the kitchen into the hall, almost knocking over Eliza Cooper, the housemaid, who was just coming into the kitchen. "There's a man in the house!" screamed Miss Evans, and fled to the front room. Miss Cooper gawped after her, and then, like a slapstick comedy victim, was almost knocked over again by a slim young man wearing a cloth cap and a muffler with a gun in his left hand, who raced after the cook. In the front room, Mr. and Mrs. Storrs and their niece, Marion Lindley, had leapt to their feet on hearing the scream. The cook repeated her breathless message to them, "There's a man in the house!" And Mr. Storrs went firmly out into the hall, followed by his womenfolk. The young man pointed the gun at him and said, "Now I've got you." Undeterred, Mr. Storrs advanced on him and seized his wrist. As the two men wrestled together, Mrs. Storrs ran past them and took down a silver-handled shillelagh that hung on the wall, a quaint souvenir of her honeymoon in Ireland. Seeing the club about to descend on his head, the young man turned his pistol on Mrs. Storrs and said, paradoxically, "I will not shoot." Mrs. Storrs grabbed the gun, thrust her shillelagh into her husband's hand, and raced upstairs to the attic in obedience to his order to her to ring the alarm bell. Marion Lindley, thinking her aunt was off to hide in a bedroom, ran out of the front door and down to the town, where she added her incoherent story to the tolling of the great bell. Mary Evans, unwilling to be left alone in the hall with the two fighting men, also ran away, found Eliza Cooper dithering outside, and hurried her off to the coach house to fetch James Worrell. Unfortunately, he was placidly enjoying his pint in the Grosvenor Hotel in town. Nor did he down it in one on hearing the great bell. Mr. Storrs had cried wolf three nights earlier, and Worrell blandly assumed that they must be testing it again. By the time help arrived at Gorse Hall, Mrs. Storrs had been tolling the bell in desperation for half an hour, and her hands had to be prized from the rope. The kitchen was a grim sight. Mr. Storrs lay on the floor, bleeding from a cut over his nose. There were slight cuts on his hands, too. But there was far more blood over the room than could be explained by these minor injuries. Wet patches on his dark clothes suggested that he had been stabbed many more times. And not long after he'd been moved onto a sofa by the window, he died of shock and loss of blood from 15 separate wounds. Two men from the Liberal Club, where Miss Lindley was being revived with brandy, were the first on the scene of the crime. They both formed the distinct impression that Storrs could have told them who his assailant was when they originally questioned him, but deliberately chose not to, asking instead for his wife. Before dying, however, he told the police that he did not know who had attacked him. There was one excellent clue, the assailant's pistol, which Mrs. Storrs had seized and hidden under an upstairs carpet. It was an unusual Belgian make, with the resounding trade name, the American Bullock, stamped on it. It was a five-shooter rather than a six-shooter. One chamber contained a rifle cartridge, which had been extraordinarily doctored by having the nose cut off to make it fit. And it was less use than a water pistol. The trigger spring was broken, the swivel pin between the hammer and the mainspring had been removed, the trigger guard was missing, and the extractor rod was badly bent. Unless the murderer had intended robbery, the motive was utterly mysterious. Nobody knew of Mr. Storrs having any enemies. The family generally dismissed the idea that it might have been sacked workmen from the family building firm of which Storrs was a director. But the police managed to round up a suspect before long. George Harry had a disreputable young first cousin. Cornelius Howard's father was a pork butcher, famous for his pies. His mother was George Henry's sister. Cornelius, however, had served several sentences for burglary and had not spoken to George Henry beyond the most casual greeting in the street since his mother's death. The police hunted for Cornelius and found him still burglariously occupied and using one of several aliases. They found blood on his trousers and his knife. He gave a patently false explanation of the blood-stained trousers, saying that a pane of glass intended for replacing a window in his former lodgings had broken and cut him. His landlord denied this. The police took him for identification by the women of Gorse Hall. With differing degrees of certainty, they all identified him, though they all agreed that he'd worn a light moustache when brandishing the gun in the hall, and that altered his appearance. Cornelius Howard was put on trial. There were three strong points in his favour. The American Bullock pistol could not be connected with him. He could not have been the earlier September intruder, the one who broke the window, who it now seemed might well have been the murderer, casing the joint. For Cornelius had been in police custody at the time, on remand for break-ins committed in Sheffield. And the women's identification of him was really rather shaky. Standing against him was his lie about the blood on the trousers, but he now offered the completely convincing explanation that he had lied because he had cut himself on a break-in with which he had not yet been charged. He produced a dubious alibi from the landlord of a dubious pub, who claimed with increasing certainty to remember Howard playing dominoes with three navvies throughout the time of the murder. Fortunately for him, the confident police witness who placed the incident one day earlier turned up in court visibly drunk and admitted that he normally consumed 15 or 16 pints a day. Cornelius was acquitted, to the delight of the public, which had started to regard him as the snubbed and disregarded poor relation of the miserly toffee-nosed Storrses of Gorse Hall. The case was back at a standstill. Then, in June 1910, a young man with a light moustache wearing a cloth cap and a muffler made a murderous attack on a harmless courting couple in a lover's lane near Gorse Hall, with such brutal observations as, "I'll cut your effing throats, I'll cut your belly out, and I'm going to cut your bloody head off." Young Mark Wilde terrorised James Bolton and his future wife, Gertrude Booth. He slashed through Bolton's muffler and stabbed his hand before running away in the face of Bolton's courageous resistance. It took the police a couple of weeks to learn that Mark Wilde had been seen hurrying home with blood on his face that night. He was identified by Bolton and Gertie and convicted of this quite meaningless assault. Mr. Justice Channel gave him a surprisingly lenient 2-month sentence for attempted murder, trying to cut Bolton's throat through the muffler. There was a purpose in this clemency. The short sentence kept him in a local prison in Cheshire, so that the police could continue their attempts to link Wilde with the Gorse Hall murder. And very successful these attempts were. The Gorse Hall women made absolutely positive identifications of Wilde as Mr. Storrs's assailant. He gave a very poor explanation of the bloodstaining on his jacket and waistcoat, which had appeared around the time of the murder. A bullet, extraordinarily cut down like the one which had been in the American Bullock pistol, was found in his house. And that pistol was positively tied to him by the testimony of 4 ex-army comrades, 3 of them distinctly friendly to Wilde. They'd seen it in his possession, with all its identifying flaws and markings. Wilde asserted that they were wrong. It was a different pistol, and he'd kept it on the mantelpiece until his mother objected so strongly that he finally took it apart and threw the pieces away in several places, where they were never found. His counsel, the rather flamboyant Edward Theophilus Nelson, a Guyanese, was the only black barrister practising in England at the time. He made much of Wilde's having voluntarily directed the police to the doctored bullet. He made absolute hay with the fact that the Gorse Hall women were making their second positive identification of a supposed murderer. And, to much public rejoicing, he got his client off. Today, Mark Wilde seems to have been a very lucky man. He did, in fact, look not at all unlike Cornelius Howard with a moustache. His undoubted assault on James Bolton and Gertrude Booth testified to the violent instability in his personality. And the American Bullock might very easily have hanged him, probably would have done, had not Howard been tried first. And crime historian Jonathan Goodman, for one, would not have believed that such a hanging was a miscarriage of justice. Local oral tradition strongly avers that Mr. Storrs had given Mark Wilde a severe thrashing for trespassing during September.